Welcome to Digital Storytelling on Mobile Platforms. I'd like to introduce Joe Lambert, who is the director and founder of the Center for Digital Storytelling. He has touched many lives throughout the world with his digital storytelling, and in turn, those stories have touched other people. And I have had the pleasure of taking some of his workshops, and they have really inspired me as well. I would also like to introduce Robin Elliott. Robin is a writer, producer, and digital media specialist with a passion for building community online and off. As the director of the Murmur Project, she leads the production of location-based story collections in cities around the world. She was a member of the founding team of ourfaves.com, a hyperlocal user-generated review site and first ever social media property to be developed by a North American media company. And we also have with us Judy Wu. She's an associate professor in the Department of History and Women's Gender and Sexuality Studies at Ohio State. And at the end down here, we have Brian Leaf, an instructional design library resident, University Libraries at Ohio State. Welcome.
Thank you, Cindy. Yay. So, I sat through the keynote and Don's presentation, and I think, how many of you were in those, stayed in this room, basically haven't left, you know? And in both of those earlier presentations, it felt like they were running through an enormous amount of material. So we're going to slow the pace down a bit here. We're going to talk about just one subject, storytelling. And we're going to talk a little bit about the way we've been experimenting with it in mobile environments. My colleague, Robin Elliott, has come down from Canada, partly because we're in a beginning of a conversation with institutions like OSU about how mobility in our particular practices are changing. But even as we're doing that, we're looking at the innovative models that existed that aren't like our particular practice, which again, I'll talk about a little bit. So what happened this week is we had a 2.5-day workshop for 11 people to make stories ideally completely on their mobile device, in this case either an iPhone or an iPad. And the kind of spirit of it was to have the material that came out of the workshop to be the visual backdrop of Ohio State University. So it both inspired the writing and acted as the visual narrative for the work. We'll be showing three of those pieces, including from Brian and Judy, at the end of this process. But we just want to introduce this very quickly. And I always start with my feeling about America, which is that inherently in our culture, we have this homo urbanus perspective, that we're atomized, that we're in our small worlds and we're communicating within our small networks, and we're not really connecting to each other. And we built places like these places that I fly over as I go place to place and I look down and I take pictures out the window that are isolating in every way. There's no center, there's no commons. People have to drive miles to get to where they're going. And it seems to me that part of the promise of digital media was that we were going to find new ways to connect. But is it true? In many ways, the creation of a commons, a place where people gather to be together and to share ideas, is the spirit of all of our efforts as educators, to create places where people want to hear and listen to each other across borders and across boundaries. In our minds, media that uses story allows that to happen in the most effective way. And storytelling for us is a kind of call to connection across differences in opinion, across differing ways of approaching issues and life. and it's to create a kind of environment where shared ideas can happen quickly and easily. For us, the issue of using mobility as part of this process emerged, obviously, as we saw X many mobile phones go into the pockets of the people we were working with, but certainly expanded a whole lot with the thinking about the way people could use geolocation, particularly the beginning of our work in kind of mapping stories to Google Maps as a process, to think about the way stories could create a connection to place, and that stories could be the way that we inhabit our environments with, you know, the ghosts of the narratives that are sitting there, both the official narratives that you think of as historical markers, but equally important is the unofficial narratives, the personal stories that exist in each place. So for the last 6 years, we traveled around the country doing this particular process, story mapping, where we were trying to get communities, often working with large education institutions. This is a project we did in Houston with the University of Houston and the Third Ward community, where we go around and we collect the stories and then we simply put them into a mapping framework. Again, this kind of work quickly grew, as all of this grew, to expectations as we take the pictures or make the videos that the machines we're using is actually doing the work for us. So when you make a picture or a video with your iPhone, it knows where you did it. It knows when you did it. And you automatically, in sending it up to many of the social sharing sites, have a geolocated piece of material that can be shared. So we're already looking at constant growth of these processes on Google Earth or other projects where people are just doing this inherently on Flickr and on Instagram and other things where you're finding the stories, the pictures connected to place. But our inspiration for this work, in many ways, was watching a project that emerged from Toronto, Canada. And I'm going to turn it over to my colleague Robin, because the work of Murmur in early 2002, 3, and 4 was a direct inspiration for the way we thought about what would change when the landscape suddenly had a way to hear the stories in this case, or connect to the stories in it. So take it away, Robin. If you want to come up here, you can come up here, or you can.
Yeah.
But you still may have to have this.
I've got a lapel mic here. Okay. I think it's on now. Hi there. So I'm Robin Elliott, and I'm here from Toronto. For the last several years, I've been running a project called Murmur. Murmur started out of the Canadian Film Center's New Media Lab. There it is. In 2002. The idea was to collect first-person stories and memories that were related to specific locations in space, buildings, park benches, parks, you know, it could be any sort of place, to record these stories and memories that were told in the first person by people with a personal connection to the material, it was their story in some way, and then make these stories available as audio art installations, essentially. So actually map them onto space before cell phones, smartphones made that really easy to do. So lots of you can annotate space in different ways now. But at the time, we sort of built our own platform, and we would put these signs up. And we actually continue to do some projects that look like this, where we put up these aluminum signs with a phone number and a code. And you could happen upon these in physical space. So there'd usually be a cluster of these in a neighborhood. So for example, if you've ever been to Toronto, the first neighborhood we ever treated in this way and did this kind of installation in was Kensington Market, which is a very storied place, lots of different waves of migration, a really storied past, a lot of draft dodgers there, this wonderful, alive place. So that was the first place we ever did a project like this. So you would walk around, you'd happen upon one of these signs, you'd call the number, and you would get a collection of memories related to that place where you were standing. So the idea was not that it would be a tour, that there was a particular sort of trace mark you would leave through the place, like that would be completely personal. You could listen to one or many of these stories, but the idea was to be completely immersed in the narrative. So the sights, the sounds, the smells, everything, maybe they would sort of say, you know, direct your gaze or walk a few steps this way. And so that's basically, in a nutshell, how Murmur operates. So very much related to psychogeography and sort of basically how psychology and geography come together and how these personal narratives can, you know, transform space if we only give people access to some of these. So the real impetus for doing this work, I'll also show you, these are some of the, this is sort of a cutoff view, but we did these hand-illustrated maps as well. So one way was to sort of happen upon it, but we did produce all kinds of illustrated maps. So it really became a community arts piece where, with local people telling the stories, local people being trained to be lay producers, or sometimes some professional producers getting involved that were interested in that particular community. This wonderful artist, Marlena Zuber, doing hand-drawn maps and all kinds of things. So it's now in 32 communities actually around the world. On four continents, so all the project is led from Toronto, and if it's a project in Toronto, then I'm sort of involved curating and collecting, but also bringing lots of community members in to do that work, and when we're working further abreast, further afield, then, you know, I'm going to sort of build capacity so that people on the ground can sort of do this work there, and then they really take ownership of the project and the production process and so on. But basically the idea was just to weave more voices into these narratives of place, have more people having a chance to shape how we feel about place, to allow people to walk through these physical spaces and let them be transformed by these new associations and this sort of prosthetic memory, you know, that they sort of snap into place like as they move through. So that's sort of it in a nutshell. But I'm really, really happy to be here with Joe Lambert because our paths and our work have sort of come into contact lots of times, and we are both really interested in memory and place and in sort of participatory media making and different mechanisms of story delivery and sort of ways of tapping into these amazing repositories, these human repositories that are all around us. So without further ado, you come back. But yeah, it was an awesome time these last 3 days here at OSU, and I have had the tremendous privilege of seeing this place through the lens of people like Judy and Brian, which is such a treat and reminds me every time that this type of work actually does the trick, because you start to care about places differently. You know, like this is not just a space, this is a real place for me now, because even by virtue of hearing, you know, 14 different stories that were produced over the last 3 days, I can walk around this campus and as though I'd been here before, I spent several years here, have associations. I think that does really good work in the world. I'll leave it at that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So what we're hoping, obviously, is that we'll get to the questions and answers in the discussion about this work and about the work we've been doing as quickly as possible. So the last transition is simply to say the tradition of our model of workshop is a three-day event where you go from story concept to finished piece. It's taught in a group dynamic, group process. And in the last years, we've been looking at how we take that outside. So on campuses, we've been doing photo-based projects. But in the last year, this iPhone workshop was taken to Istanbul and to Barcelona. We thought Columbus was the natural third beautiful city to go to. And the idea was simply focus much more on the photographic component as an entry in, and to say to the people, what, you know, what's the prompt that gets them started? In this workshop we used, why are you here in the broadest sense? Why are you in this room? Who are you through this work? And to go out with the why I'm here prompt to take some photographs. It led to these stories. So what I would do is turn it over to you, Brian, first to have you introduce your story, and then we'll play that, and then we'll play Judy's story, and then we'll have some discussion, and then we'll go with the last story. So, Brian, whatever you want to say about the experience of making the movie before we show it.
Hello? Is this on?
So cliche, but so true. Is this thing on?
This one is. Johnny,
is it? Oh, yeah.
Sure. There you go. Okay, cool. I'm not sure if I have too many explicit thoughts. I'm still sort of reflecting on the process. It's been pretty intense the past 3 days, but it has been a fantastic experience, and you know, with the 2.5 minutes of video that I created, it's just a very small part, a very small perspective, but it was very powerful of, it was a very powerful process in trying to develop it. And yeah, I have lots and lots of pages of notes that I've already taken since this has started and ended. So if you have any questions for me later, you're feel free to ask me, but I think I'll just leave you with the video.
Let the work speak for itself.
When I was little, I was chastised by my parents for wasting film on rocks and dirt in a neighborhood ditch. But to me, it wasn't just some random landscape. It was my Terabithia. I was king, and I was taking record of my kingdom. It was a place where I was free to imagine without fear of judgment or constraint to logic. It was my place of joy. Many people grow out of such childish flights, and I certainly learned to say things like, I wanted to capture how the sunlight accents the landscape in a way that suggests something designed and not accidental. Or something like that. It's not to say that I'm not truthful. The things that have gained me entrance into my new career are important to me, but I refuse to let the institution limit or displace my childhood fantasies. For a long time, I thought the two were mutually exclusive and that growing up meant, as my dad would say, getting serious. But those things that have excited my imagination have also inspired me to design, create, and see differently. But does it always have to have some sort of explicit utility? In spite of what I was sometimes told means being a professional, I'm allowing it to become a persistent daydream. I'm allowing myself to look down and see a gateway that leads up. These days, I walk around campus, and like every other campus, some building is always under renovation. As such, I will walk on makeshift gravel ramps and navigate around fenced-off areas. But in my mind's eye, the former is sometimes transformed into my world's version of Avalon, an island surrounded by a concrete black sea. The latter is sometimes a labyrinth in which one wrong choice means certain death. But fortunately, in the sometimes kingdom I overlook, I have my Excalibur. And with it, I will not be judged.
You want to stop the music, but you know, for the sake, obviously. You can see the experiment was also a little bit with the iPhone app called Hipstagram. Hipstamatic, that's right. I've got Instagram in my brain. And Hipstamatic encourages a kind of different way of seeing. And it was very interesting to see how many of those photos versus the, quote, normal camera inside the iPhone were used. So Judy, while you say something, I will get your movie ready to play.
Good morning, everybody. I want to say, first of all, that being in a workshop with Joe and Robin is amazing. I really feel like this is doing soul search work, and it really inverts the process of learning. When you go into a room, often you're there to absorb information. And instead, when we go to these storytelling settings, what we're doing is that we're uncovering the storyteller in all of us. And it's such a democratic, empowering form of learning to think that we all have something unique and important to say about our lives, and that what we learn about ourselves is something that's important for other people to share. Something I really learned from this particular experience is to be more inspired by my environment, and this is something that we all talked about during the workshop, that usually we're so busy. We're busy parking or biking to school. We're busy running from one office to the next. We're busy running from classroom to classroom. And we're just trying to get through space to get to what we think is the most important thing that we need to do. And so the process of going out into campus and taking shots of bicycles, construction signs, buildings, or just little things that are around campus really made us forced to stop and think about, well, what is it that we like about this place? What inspires us? What can this connection help us rethink who we are? I'll just say quickly that I've been involved in digital storytelling for a long time before I even learned how to do it myself. I was coordinating the Asian American Studies program in 2005 at OSU, and at the time we wanted to do something to commemorate the internment of Japanese Americans during World War II. And we came up with this idea of having students work in teams to interview people who live in Ohio now who had been interned during World War II. And it was just a really amazing process. One of the students who became involved in this, this project was an undeclared sophomore, and she eventually became a documentary filmmaker. She graduated from the American University just a couple years ago, and now she works at NASA. So it was just a transformative experience. At the time, I had very little knowledge about how to actually do it myself technically, but I really valued the idea that stories were important. And it's not just me personally, but it's really significant for my discipline, history. History is the telling of the past, and traditionally it's relied on using written records, government sources, censuses, letters. But as people wanted to understand what are some more democratic ways of storytelling, different demographic ways of telling history, we turned to oral histories, talking to people who perhaps in the past were not literate, or perhaps whose voices they didn't consider important enough to record into paper form. So I really see that this is part of a broader process of rethinking how do you tell stories about the past, how do you teach, and so hopefully I can share with you some of my ideas of how I've been trying to implement this in my classrooms.
And now her movement.
I like hearing the rhythm of deep yoga breathing. I just can't do it. I've always breathed through my mouth, not my nose. Even so, I become more aware of air entering, filling, and exiting my body. I think about how this is still new to me. I grew up with my head buried in books or practicing piano. In graduate school, I decided I had enough of the life of the mind. Through tennis, I discovered that I had an athletic, even graceful self. I embraced singles. I relied on patience, speed, and a wicked backhand to wear down my opponents, even those half my age, capable of hitting the fuzz off the balls. But nowadays, I have more aches and pains. The player on the other side gets younger every year. So I'm learning the art of doubles. There's great pleasure in forming a partnership, discussing strategy, setting each other up for the put away, and supporting one another, even when we double fault or blow easy shots. I'm recognizing the benefits of being brave, poaching without second guessing, hitting the clutch serve. I can't always do it. It's not my natural tendency. I'm inclined to be on the baseline, stay cautious, safe, defend rather than attack. How does one play and live without fear, anticipate danger, yet embrace it? The words of a tennis teacher returned to me. Breathe. Breathe in and breathe out with every stroke. See the words and watch the spin on the ball. Focus with mindful awareness. The singing of the yoga instructor, the stirring of the other students revive me from my final meditation. I still have questions, but I am learning.
Behind suitcase of memories, time.
So as you can see from these, you know, first two pieces, obviously we take a very personal approach to storytelling. And I guess it comes from our belief that in contemporary communication, this effective connection that we have with a lived person's experience told from their heart to your heart is what makes us listen in a world filled with lots of stories, with lots of data. And we've kind of come to the point of view that there's a way to take any story and put it in the context of a personal frame, whether the subject matter is that which you would normally deal with in an expository manner, or subject matter in areas of content where it's very natural that it would be about lived experience, as in history, the social sciences, the health and human service professions. All those are natural places for stories, but we're also seeing a lot of stories happening in the context of science and technology and STEM education. So we wanted to open this up immediately for your questions, see how that goes, and we have several other stories we could show. But we thought it would be very useful to hear from you early in this session the kind of questions you have about the use of storytelling in general, or specifically about the changing nature of this work because of mobile devices. So are there any questions to start? Well, you know, it's a good question. The rule of thumb for years has been for, in the editing process, it's 3 hours of editing for every 1 minute of film. Just editing, you know, but the fact of the matter is, everything is about finish, right? Obviously, we're falling apart here. It depends on the innovation process, how quickly you get done with these things, so that we're working in environments where people are doing this process in 2 hours. Where the, if you think about it, a piece of writing, I got them to write something in 8 minutes. They could read that piece of writing and take these photographs over a 45-minute walk, and then assembling them on the tool, once they know even the basics of this very simple tool, video editing tools. In this case, we were using iMovie and Splice on the iPhones. Could be done in an hour. So it is conceivable that in a two-hour environment, you could make a film like this, as long as you didn't want to work it too much. The work, and they can speak to this, the work of writing and the work of getting to the story takes as long as you want it to. Go ahead, Judy.
I was gonna say, every time I've created one of these, I just can become completely absorbed. Sometimes when I'm trying to read at night, I just can't anymore, my eyes are drooping. But when I work on this, I can stay up until 2 o'clock, 4 o'clock, and you can just, it just completely absorbs your life. And I think it's because the stories are really meaningful. And I have the same type of experience when I sign this for classrooms. I've given this either as a final assignment or as an option for a final assignment for my classes. And students can choose a topic that they are particularly passionate about, come up with something they want to say about it. So it's about an argument. But they might be making that argument in story form, or they might be using visuals, or they might be using music, or they might be using timing or humor to make the point that they're trying to make. And when they do it, they tell me they spend a lot more time working on this than they do writing a paper, right? Because they care so much about every single element of it. So I think it is a very practical question. You know, what is the time investment? But I think it's not just the amount of time that you put in, but it's the amount of your soul and your mind and your willingness to kind of engage in that project. And I think this has that potential to unlock that for people who are interested in engaging this type of process.
Brian, did you want to add? Mm-hmm. From beginning to end of a process, yeah. I mean, to view it like, yes. Right. I mean, the typical three-day workshop is based on a 21-hour curriculum. Obviously, we have students like Judy who leave and keep working. The great filmmaker John Ford says, you don't finish a film, you just walk away. So we often have to peel people's fingers off the computer to get them to stop. So I'm sort of putting it into a spectrum that's obviously about quality, but it's more about process. Our call to personal stories and the questions we ask as we sit in a story circle provoke people into some hard work about issues that they're facing and the insights that they're trying to pull out of those processes. And for many people, it's the first time that they've gone public with a kind of narrative about something that's important to them. I mean, I don't think you probably talk a lot about your physical, cultural life, but that idea requires one to invest in a different way. And then time seems to fill it up. You're not satisfied with that picture, you need another picture. You want to make the timing of it just right, you start thinking about which pieces of music, not one piece of music, but several pieces of music. Suddenly it's a much more elaborate production. And obviously we still think this is like baby steps into film, right? This is introduction to filmmaking. It is skills that can be taken in very sophisticated levels, but inherent in our work is that the production component of it is as simple as possible, as in an iPhone camera. And there's all the video or still images you're shooting are on that camera, not with a fancy $5,000 video camera and not with fancy audio equipment or whatever. It's as simple as it can be. But we find that's enough to make compelling work that people want to see. Go ahead.
Oh, yeah, I was just going to say, I think what was really really unique about this workshop was the fact that we were using mobile devices. And it was a 2.5-day workshop, 9 to about 5 o'clock every day. But for me, it was 9 to 5, then 8 to 1 a.m. And there's some powerful things you can do with a mobile device, and there's a lot of investment that you can put into it. But I definitely agree with Joe and Judy. It's the amount of... You know, it's being invested in it, doing it for yourself, doing it for the community that you're in. I think the last morning that we were working, I was pacing back and forth, listening over and over and over again. But I think that's sort of the benefit of the community. You will keep finding things, and it will, you know, I could have spent another 10 hours on it probably, but if it made it any better, yeah, probably not. But I had people that were around that could listen to it.
As it moves past me. Hi. I think, just very quickly, in terms of investment of time, I mean, if you think about any creative process or even writing a paper for that matter, I mean, how much time goes into any page of good writing? I mean, distilling ideas to make them powerful or on point or whatever, and this way that's multimedia or in any, with any, I mean, writing's a technology too, you know, is worth doing because it's effective, and it's also the process, as Joe is also, as everyone's saying, I think it's really part of it. But yeah, I think it's worthwhile. Good time spent. Anywho.
I was just going to make one other point, which is that when Brian was talking about the fact that he could spend another 10 hours editing the piece, I do feel that doing this type of project helps our students think about revising in a different way. When I ask them to write papers, I always tell them to write a draft and then rewrite and rewrite, and they usually don't do it. But when they see it on video, there's something about that, that's something much more immediate that they can share, that they want to go back and say, okay, is that the right line? Is this the right image? Is this the right music? Is the timing right? And so those type of editing skills, I think is what's hopefully they will translate back into other aspects of their lives. And also, I remembered this with the oral history project that we did. The students got a much clearer sense of the power they had as authors of knowledge. After they completed the oral histories with their subjects, they went back and created mini documentaries. And they realized that depending on which excerpt of the interview they chose, they could change the representation of that experience. Right? And this is something that we're trying to get them to understand, is that they are not just objectively absorbing knowledge. In fact, they are recreating knowledge. They're interpreters of knowledge. And I think there's something about this multimedia project that really reinforces that for them.
Go ahead.
Can I answer it with a movie? Cynthia, is it okay? Yeah, thank you. And then you're welcome to take the mic and explain what you think about that question.
My soul travels two paths, that of a scientist and that of an artist. I wonder if others see the whole of me, or do they judge me by each half? My world is composed of color, pattern, texture, and form. It is directed by non-conforming creativity. To me, a tree becomes a landscape for the small and unnoticed. White, yellow, green. Neighbors in a dry land. How do they survive? The moss with tiny leaves and stems hibernates until enough moisture allows the leaves to spread and feed from the light of the sun. The yellow and white lichens are composed of a dual relationship of a fungus and an alga, where each partner relies on the others for survival. Answers lead to more questions. Why can they live here when their relatives on the moist ground cannot? Will they still live on this same patch of arid terrain 2 years from now? I am a botanist with a passion for the small. I am a scientist with an artist's point of view. I see pink Christmas bulbs on a Christmas tree, but it's April. What are the pink bulbs? Why are they here? Look closer. Bright pink leaves cluster together to protect developing seeds. In a year, at maturity, the leaves will become brown and spread. Wing seeds drop and disperse in the wind. What are the pink Christmas bulbs? The answer is in the pattern. I am a scientist looking in from the outside into the narrow world of scientific inquiry. Judged by deduction, inferences, and conclusions. Judged by the sterility of the question. But I can't conform to the straight and narrow. I see art and science, and it becomes my inspiration for the questions behind the science. Two different roads, one soul. Do you see me? Do you value both sides of me?
So, Cynthia, I don't know if you want to say something. Because it's not really the answer to the question, but I wanted to give you a context of how one could go into material, but mainly you're going into your inquiry process as your individual process. That's the way I would read that. Do you want to add?
Not about just an
Go ahead.
Well, I mean, I think we all know what a script by committee turns into, and one of, I think that's it's a kind of honest issue about co-creativity and authorship, that inevitably in a production process, the point of view of the author emerges from the loudest voice or the most, you know, likely screenwriter in the group. For us, as a result, we've always tried to make those group projects have representations of all of the voices. And then the connective process, whatever way that you tie the different voices together, work. And we've dealt with all sorts of subject matter where that notion of these little stories tying into a bigger story, so that 10 little stories become a half an hour film about what those engineering students thought, and as opposed to the idea that they're making a collective half an hour film. And often the engagement works better that way, you know, because each of them feels like they have a degree of ownership. I don't question in any of the work that we do that we're solving the kinds of problems of what we just saw, challenge-based learning, in terms of the process of authorship in relationship to group process. We don't have a clear answer to say, you know, how a group mind is formed that locks in on a story. We have hard enough times when husbands and wives try to do it, or parents and children. You know, This is why individual authorship is so important. Go ahead.
I just echo what Joe said. I think that the sort of perspective and the point of view is the what makes a story really good. So I would also advocate for sort of bringing out small pieces of story in any one of those individual students and then bringing them together in some way. And in a way, even that's sort of what Murmur does, and I've done that in other contexts as a teacher and so on. But the more you're trying to come to consensus or co-create and stuff, you can sometimes lose everything that is valuable, really, you know. It's the personal in it all, or the, you know, specific perspective of any one of those participants that is actually giving you something that's tremendously valuable, and then bringing all of that together to see how they all connect, or the themes there, or where there are points of consensus, but they happened independently of one another, you know, and then you realize, like, that's where things get really juicy, I think. Yeah.
I want to try to get one more question. Sure. So go ahead, and we'll try to come back to this. Part of this, I also want to say, in the afternoon session, we're going to be talking very specifically about the use of digital storytelling in higher education. So some of these questions we can also hit there. And I want to see if we can move towards some of the mobility issues. But go ahead.
Actually, I was just learning about a resource. Are you at OSU or are you at someplace? Okay, there is a workshop, digital storytelling workshop that Karen Diaz and Nancy, you run on a quarterly or semester-long basis, and they were just saying that it's undersubscribed. So if you're a faculty member and you're interested in introducing this with you to your classroom, there are support services available that you can coordinate with your classes. So is the digital storytelling program, I think, Is that right? Is that the program that's running the classes?
To answer the question, I want to answer very specifically, which is our emphasis in a normal environment is to get extremely good audio right, which is technically critical to this process, and then be very basic in terms of the image approaches. You know, you can see these things are more like slideshows on steroids than they are films, right? And by kind of removing production, particularly film production, and higher-end audio production from the process, then the accessibility increases. But there is a technical training. Everybody here made the movie themselves, right? It's not people making the movie for them. So there's that basic training in the tool set.
I will say that I think what's most important is having the story idea. And I've taught digital narratives in different formats. And I think there's ways in which the students might acquire the technical tools but not necessarily have an understanding about why they're doing that. So I think it's really important to have a sense of what is the story or what is the argument that you want to make. And I think that's where the group projects can emerge more productively, is that if there is a topic, if there's something that as a collective people want to say, then it could be a productive relationship. And there might be people within that setting, some people might be more inclined towards writing, others might be more inclined towards visuals or music. So you can draw upon different forms of expertise.
I think we got time for one more question.
Just
and
very
Robin,
quickly,
go ahead.
I do think that aside, it's not really about like focus on the technology or the tools, but I think that some discussion around like illustrating story using these things, like some small conversation about metaphorical use of image, or like we do some things to get people walking and thinking about, you know, image in relation to the story in a certain way that maybe they don't always. That's a little bit different than being, you know, experts in photography or, you know, image making. But I think that is key to getting, you know, like to having the best, the most effective sort of end product, that relationship between the narrative and the image. But
that's all. Dickie, do you mind if I call on the person in the front here? Because you get time to talk later today. So I can say that to a fellow Texan. I can just give my heart.
I just have a question about whether these narratives live on after events like today or a three-day workshop. Do you archive them? Are they accessible to the general public? Or?
Yeah, I mean, the community of practice that's become digital storytelling is an international practice in which you can go to many universities, many contexts to see their, you know, sites filled with stories. The university, OSU, has a wonderful collection that is public, but there are inevitably stories that are quasi-public, meaning they don't make it quite to full visibility, sometimes because people use copyrighted music, I won't name names, but sometimes it's because the subject matter is they don't want to make it for everybody, and so we've done a lot of work with subject matter that has to stay inside a privacy environment. The work is rich inside that environment, but in some ways these stories were never meant to be vehicles of film competition or exposition. They're part of a working process. And again, that doesn't mean there aren't thousands that you can see online, but.
Digital story work that's going on in the world that may be a little bit separate from the CDS tradition. So yeah, absolutely, archives and other people are interested in, you know, preserving all of this digital history so it doesn't sort of go up in the ether. There's some anxiety around that, I think, among a lot of people. There are all kinds of ways to create these sorts of repositories, and I'm also involved in something like with the University of Toronto called History in Its Publics, which is like cross-disciplinary, and they're bringing in projects like mine because they think there's a lot of really valuable information there, and creating platforms and things. So that very similar to an idea that came up in the first session, actually, about this sort of data mapping. And so I think that some of these collections of stories are actually becoming like a legitimate source of data of all kinds, and that's really exciting.
Yeah. We're out of time, right? Yeah, so I'm sorry to the hands. Information real quick, and then we got to say goodbye to these nice people.
Yeah.
We thank you enormously. We're keeping you from lunch. We won't keep you any longer. Thank you very much.